I'd like to pray for Michael and for this session.
Thank you.
Almighty God, we thank you so much for this morning. We thank you for everything you have in store for us today. And we pray that you would continue speaking to us through the words you gave to Michael. And he's going to say to us, Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit is here in this place. We pray that you would open our hearts for your word and that you would have a word for our hearts in this morning. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning. I hope you are all doing well. I've been getting up early every morning to try and make sure I have an outline to share with the translators. I'm not a morning person. One of the first times I preached in Europe was with a preacher and writer by the name of John Stott. Some of his books are for sale in the bookstore, and I highly recommend them. The first time I preached with Uncle John, someone rang me and said, Michael, you need to know something. When you are preaching with him, he will take notes on everything you say. And if he disagrees, he will say nothing to you at the conference. But after the conference, when you go to the airport together, he will say to you, I am the member of a business club with the airline. Would you like to come and have a cup of coffee with me? And when you have a cup of coffee in your hand, he will say, can I talk to you about a few things? And that is when he will tell you if he feels you made a mistake. So sure enough, we preached together. 3 days later, we're in the airport. He says, Michael, I am the member of a business club here. Would you like a cup of coffee? And inside, I'm thinking, anything John Stott wants to correct me about is fine with me. So he gives me a cup of coffee, and then he says, can I tell you a few things? And I took a notebook. I said, anything, tell me anything you want. He said, Michael, you told the story when you were preaching of a man called George Buttrick. Like, yes. He said, I knew George Buttrick. He was a friend of mine. And now I'm thinking this story which I told, which I heard from someone else, is probably wrong. What I said was, after he'd finished preaching one morning, a lady came to George and said, that was the most amazing sermon I have ever heard. You must have the most incredible times of prayer with the Lord in the morning. And he looked at her, the preacher, and he said, Madam, before I've had 5 cups of coffee, I'm an atheist. So now I'm thinking about this story, and I'm thinking I may be in big trouble. John Stott said, Michael, I know the woman to whom you refer. And I know exactly what he said to her. And I'm thinking, I'm in so much trouble. He said, what he actually said to her was, Madam, before I've had 6 cups of coffee in the morning, I am an atheist. And then I said, is there anything else? He said, nope, that's it. So me getting up early in the morning, this is one of the reasons I didn't want to go into Christian ministry. Christians love having prayer breakfasts. I was designed for prayer dinners. So I hope what I say this morning will be clear. Someone once came to a colleague of mine after they finished preaching and said, you know what? I've listened to you very carefully and I'm still confused, but at a much higher level than before. So let's pray and ask the Lord for clarity. Now, we talked yesterday a lot about culture, and possibly the largest cultural shift that I've ever seen, and possibly one of the most unusual global cultural shifts the world has ever seen. And Jonah, we heard, is struggling with the injustice of what he sees. And he has moral questions, and he thinks God's moral reasoning is wrong. That God may be wrong in what he's saying and wrong in what he's doing. And he runs away. But there are other questions we have too. A couple of months ago, I read this in one of the world's largest newspapers. The journalist said, "For the past half a century, we have tried to construct a world without identity and morality. Instead, we have left it to two systems to deal with the problem of our collective life, to the market economy and to the liberal democratic state. Morality has been outsourced to the market. The market gives us choices, and morality has been reduced into a set of choices in which right and wrong have no meaning beyond the satisfaction of my desire or the frustration of my desire." You see what he's saying? When we think of morality, the only question we ask is, will this satisfy my desire or will it frustrate my desire? We find it increasingly hard to understand why there might be things that we want to do, we can afford to do, but we should not do. We do not recognize there are things we should not do because they are dishonorable or disloyal or demeaning. They make us less than we should be. In a word, there are things which are unethical. Too many people in positions of public trust have come to the conclusion that if you can get away with it, you would be a fool not to do it. That is how leaders betray the public they were meant to serve. And when that happens, trust collapses, and civilization begins to decay and die. Meanwhile, liberal democratic states have abolished our sense of our national identities. The effect is to turn society from a home into a hotel. In a hotel, you pay the price, you get a room, and you are free to do whatever you want. But a hotel is not a home. It doesn't generate loyalty, and it generates no sense of belonging. Now, I'd love to meet this journalist and ask him a few questions about why he said what he said. But parts of this are very true. We all need a sense of identity, who am I, and morality, how I should live. And in any country or people, these two things inform how we understand who we are and how we should act. And as we come back to the book of Jonah, we see in Jonah that he is struggling with both of these. He's lost a sense of his true identity and also of true morality. He's forgotten both. So we only read the first three verses of Jonah chapter 1 yesterday. At this speed, it will take me 3 months to finish this series. The organizers of this conference have begged me not to do that. So let's say a few more words about chapter 1, and then we move into chapter 2. In chapter 1, and you find this on page 14 of your book, you will see the people ask Jonah a lot of questions. Jonah is now on the boat, and the storm comes. They wake him up, they ask him to pray, he doesn't pray. And then they come back to Jonah, and they say, "Who is responsible for this? What do you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? Of what people are you?" They are asking a question of identity and morality. Who are you? And what is going on? God uses a group of non-believers to speak to Jonah to remind him of who he is. And after Jonah gives his initial answer, they ask more questions. What have you done? And what should we do in order to get out of this? It's an incredible sense of questions they ask Jonah. Jonah is a Hebrew. He is a member of the nation of Israel. Why did God choose Israel? Well, in Ezekiel chapter 16, we are told God chose Israel not because they were beautiful, not because they were famous, not because they were rich, not because they had anything, but because he loved them. It was his grace. He loved them. As a matter of fact, God says, when I found you, you were naked, you were dirty, you were in the gutter, and I saved you, and I washed you, and I clothed you, and I gave you beauty, and I gave you fame, and I made you successful. The history of the people with which Jonah is a part is a history of love and grace. God says, I loved you, I have blessed you, and yet now you turn away from me. God is speaking through these questions asked by non-Christians to remind Jonah of his true identity, his true belief, and who he truly, what he truly believe, should believe about God. But before they can ask these questions, they need to ask the first question, which is, why are you sleeping? Because you can't speak to someone who is asleep. Now, I'm speaking to some people who are asleep. Most of you are awake. But because we have video, we'll find the sleeping people. We'll find your name, your country, and I will come and visit you. So they wake him up first in order to speak to him. But how can Jonah sleep in the storm? There is a huge storm. I don't know if you've ever been on a boat in a big storm. It is scary. My family and I once got caught in a small storm off the coast of South Africa. We were in a little boat, and the waves were coming up and down, and the boat went up and down, and our stomachs went up and down. But when the boat went down low, and the water came up, you couldn't see anything. It went dark. And when you looked up, all you could see was the sky, because there was a wall of water around us, and it was scary. But we were fine. That was a small storm. Imagine a big storm. How can Jonah sleep? Now, Jesus fell asleep in a boat. But Jesus slept in a boat because he had peace with God. And they wake him up and say, why are you sleeping? We're going to die. And Jesus goes, and he speaks one word, and the sea goes calm. But Jonah sleeps not because he has peace, but because he's most probably depressed. I don't know if any of you have wrestled with depression or know people who've suffered with depression. When you're depressed, you sleep a lot. And Jonah is running from God. He is angry. He is sad at what may happen. And he just falls into a deep, deep sleep. And they wake him up. One of the questions we have to ask ourselves is, as we look at the world in which we live, are we actually asleep? Sometimes the church goes to sleep. We go to sleep especially when we lose hope. When we think that everything is hopeless, that God can do nothing. But that is not the message, actually, of this chapter or of this book. There is always hope. We're going to come to it in a minute. Now, what makes the hope easy to see is when you see how far Jonah ran away. Jonah went, the Bible says in verse 3, down to Joppa. Then in the next verse, down into the boat. Then into the next verse, down into the bottom of the boat. So he's going further down. That would make you think you can't go any lower. But then he gets thrown headlong into the sea, literally, is what the scripture says. Jonah says, throw me head first. If you jump into a swimming pool feet first, you go down, you start to come up. You throw them head first, wearing clothes, you're just sucked all the way down. So he goes down. He's still going down. And then he goes even deeper down. And in chapter 2, he says, I went to the bottom of the sea. And then he says, all the way to the land of the dead, to Sheol, to hell, literally, as far away from God as you can possibly go. Jonah's running away from God is total. He cannot go any further. And Jonah is learning, however, that there is a big difference between suffering for doing God's will and suffering for not doing God's will. The church is filled with all kinds of inspiring stories of what happens when you suffer for doing God's will. But Jonah is now suffering because he is not doing God's will. He is disobedient. Is it possible some of us in this room are in very deep suffering because of our disobedience right now? Does it feel like you're drowning? And if the feeling is overwhelming, we ask questions. Is there any hope? My guilt is so great. Will God hear me? There are times when it feels God's call on our life is challenging the very basis of who I am. It's so difficult to obey. It's like he's asking us to do something and it feels impossible. And actually, it is impossible. But the good news is that God wants to change us. God wants to transform ourselves. He wants to transform us. Sometimes you talk to business people and they've run away with someone they work with in the office, and they will say things like, I couldn't help myself. That's just the way I am. God made me that way. Or I just fell in love. How could I deny it? I had to do this and betray everything. And the answer to this is no and yes. There's a part of this which is true. Yes, we cannot change ourselves. We cannot transform ourselves. We cannot redeem ourselves. We cannot save ourselves. That is true. Some people, when they listen to the gospel being preached, think the gospel is bad news. Why? Because the message seems to be something like this. You're a sinner and you can't save yourself and God will judge you. It's like you're in the sea and you're drowning in a sea of sin. And you're trying to swim to get out. And no matter how hard you try, the further you sink. And then you drown. And then God comes and punishes you for drowning. Now, is that fair? Well, if that is the gospel, that is not fair. But imagine this. Imagine you're in the sea. You're drowning in it. You can't swim. Someone comes and offers you their hand and says, take my hand, I'll pull you out. And you say, oh no, if I get out, I'll do it on my own. And the guy in the boat says, you're crazy. You can't swim. Look at the waves, you're drowning. Take my hand, I will pull you out. And you say, no, 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 not interested. And then you drown. Now, does this change the story? The message of the gospel is that in Christ, God reaches out his hand of salvation to all of us. He says, you can't get out of this mess. Take my hand. I'll pull you out. Have you put your hand in his? He is able to save. God is reaching out to Jonah all the way through this book. The book of Jonah is not really a book of prophecy. It is a book about a prophet. First, God speaks to Jonah with a voice. He doesn't listen. He runs away, so then God sends a storm. He still doesn't listen. Then God speaks to Jonah through the non-believing sailors. He still doesn't listen. Eventually, Jonah says, "Throw me into the sea," and he gets swallowed up by a giant fish. And now, all of a sudden, he's interested in listening. But here's what's interesting. Notice in Jonah chapter 1, read it carefully when you reflect on this later. Where is Jonah's prayer? The captain says, "Pray." But he doesn't pray. Jonah doesn't pray until chapter 2, until he's in the water. He is silent. Now, there are two reasons why we are silent as believers. Number one, we don't know what to say, and we can't say it. I have a privilege of having various older members on our team who are incredibly inspiring to me. There is nothing more inspiring than meeting people who've walked with the Lord a long time and still love him. It's very inspiring. One of those people who works with us now is called John Bechtel. For many years, for about 30 years, he helped run one of the largest Christian foundations in the world, which could probably given away more money for Christian mission than any other group in the world. So he's seen a lot of mission. He was born to missionary parents. He wasn't born in the West. When he speaks to audiences like you, the first line he says is, "Like everything else you're wearing, I was made in China." That is where he was born. His parents were missionaries to China. He went to a good Christian school. He graduated top of the class. He was active in his church. He went to a good Christian university. He graduated top of his class. He was offered his first job as a school teacher. As he is traveling down to the school, he gets a letter promoting him to headmaster. It's a small school. There are only two other teachers. One of them had done something very bad. The other one couldn't lead. So they said, "Okay, now you're in charge." So he arrives, he's the headmaster. He's there for 2 days. And the judge of the town comes to him, the law judge. He says, "John, come to my house. I want to introduce you to the head of the hospital." He goes to the judge's house. The judge says, "John, I want you to meet the head of the hospital, and I'm the judge. All three of us believers, we are now going to tell people about Jesus." John said, "How do you do that?" They said, "Follow us." They get in a car. They drive 2 miles, they park. They get out of the car. John says, "What are you going to do?" They said, "We go to doors, we knock on the door, we tell people about Jesus." John's thinking, feeling nervous. They go to the first door. They knock it. A woman opens it. She is wearing a bathrobe. She has rollers in her hair. And she's holding a cup of coffee. John Bechtel is 6'6". The judge is 6'7". The head of the hospital, 6'8". If you need meters, you need to ask someone who was born later than me. That's tall. The judge looks at the woman and says, "Madam, my name is Judge Smith. I am the judge of this town. This is John. He is the headmaster of the local school. And this is my other friend, Mark. He is the head of the hospital. We want to come and talk to you." She stands with her coffee and she goes, "Oh my God." The judge says, "That is correct. We wish to speak to you about your God." They walk into the front room. And the wife looks at her husband. He is wearing a vest, small vest, naked arms, shorts, holding a beer, watching TV. The wife says, "Darling, these men want to speak to us. This is the judge. This is the head of the hospital. This is the headmaster of the school." The man looks at them, big eyes, and says, "Oh my God." The judge says, "That is correct. We wish to speak to you about your God." They sit down in this small house. And the judge turns to John Bechtel and says, John, tell these good people about Jesus Christ. John spoke for 30 minutes and said nothing. At the end of 30 minutes, his face was red. He got up, he said, I can't do this, and he walked out of the house. The judge chased him out of the house, said, where are you going? John said, I'm done. I can't do this. And the judge says, well, what about all these other houses? And John says, you're on your own. And the judge says, it's a long way back to walk from where we came. He said, I'll walk. It was the longest walk of his life. Christian parents, Christian school, church, university. He couldn't speak the gospel. And for the first time, he realized he needed help if he was to ever tell anyone about Jesus. No one had taught him to do it. Can you? Sometimes we're silent because we don't know what to say. But the reason for Jonah's silence is different. He's too ashamed to speak. He knows the truth. He knows the message. He knows about repentance. He cannot say it. He cannot even pray. Eventually, when they say, what should we do? So now the non-believers ask the believer for a prophetic word. Tell us what to do. Jonah says, throw me into the sea. And everything will be fine. It's because of me this is happening to you. And they throw him into the sea, and the sea is still, and the people on the boat believe. Well, wouldn't you? This is incredible. God is reaching out to Jonah. Now, here's the other interesting thing we learn about the boat. In the boat, the non-believers who believe in false gods and have false ideas about God are doing the right thing. They are praying. They are throwing the cargo into the sea to make the boat lighter so it will float. They're trying to row ashore. Wrong belief, right action. Jonah, however, believes in the true God. And he has true belief. But his actions are wrong. He's not praying. He's not seeking the Lord. He's not helping. He's doing nothing. It is a very sad truth that we can believe the right things, know the true God, and do nothing about it. As you look at your life, what does your life say about you? It's an old question, but a good one. If you were put on trial today and accused of being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? Where is the evidence in your life right now? You see, in this story, it's full of surprises. We expect the non-believers not to want to repent, in my sense, not to turn to God and to die. And you expect the prophet to tell them, you must repent, you must turn to God, and he will forgive you. But what happens in this story? Jonah is happy with destruction, but the non-believers want deliverance. And they're even asking Jonah, what should we do? The non-believers are asking for it. I have another colleague, much younger. His name is Dan. He was speaking at a university about a year and a half ago on sex. As you know, speaking on sex in Europe is entirely non-controversial. It was the largest lecture theater at the university, and it was full. People were standing outside. You could feel the tension in the room. Here is how he started his talk. He said, our culture is saying two different things about sex. Number one, it's purely physical and it doesn't matter. And number two, it's more than physical and it really matters. You hear it in our songs, take me to your heaven, and so on. And he said, I'm here to tell you today that half of what we sing about in our songs is true. Everybody now leant forward. He preached very well. At the end of his preach, he said, I will give you 2 minutes to think of questions. And as he was coming back up, the captain of one of the big sporting teams came to him, grabbed him, and said, I can't stay. I need to leave now. But what should I do? And Dan, not sure what to say, as he was walking up the steps to speak again, was, you need to bend your knee. So the guy went, okay, I'll go to my room and I'll do that. And then Dan thought, that makes no sense. Why did I say that? He said, leave your email with my friend before you leave. I need to write to you. The next morning, he gets a phone call. Can you have lunch with me and my sporting team? So they meet around the table. The captain of the team looks at all the other team and he bangs the table. He says, guys, we're living wrong. He says, we're sleeping with everyone we want to sleep with. We're watching as much pornography as we want. Every time we see a girl, we give them a ranking from 1 to 10. And we're empty. We're being destroyed by it. This man will tell us what to do. Dan explained the gospel to them. And an hour later, one of them with tears in his eyes said, what should we do? And the captain said, you have to bend the knee. And in the restaurant, they all got down on their knees and they became Christians. There are some people who are desperate for deliverance. They are looking for a way out. And we need to wake up at times to some of the opportunity which is before us. There are some people who hate us, and there are others who oppose, and there are others who are desperate for a word of hope. Will you be that person? Jonah isn't doing what he should do. How are we doing? We say we believe in prayer, right? Do you pray? We say that we believe God can change your life. Is your life changed? We say we have no fear of death because we will be raised on the last day. Are you living without fear? Look, I know how hard this can be. Almost a year ago, I was in a country I won't name, speaking to many, well, I was meant to be speaking to believers. The morning I was meant to preach, a big bomb went off in the city I was in. I had been speaking with a government minister the day before, and he, who was a non-believer. He sent his bomb-proof, bulletproof car to drive me to where I was going. He was worried for my safety. When we arrived at the church in the middle of nowhere, the army was outside protecting the church. They were worried the church would be bombed. But because the army were outside, and because I arrived in a government car, all the people in the town, all the non-believers of a different religion, came to the church, wanting to know what is going on. So I have a message for believers. I'm 2 sentences into preaching, and someone runs up to me and says, you have to preach a different message. So I close my notebook, I open my Bible, and I say, I have some good news for you all. I will never forget the tears as they ran down people's faces, as they gave their lives to the Lord. Sometimes our unwillingness to go where it is dangerous may mean that we're missing out on some of what God has for us. It's one of the most incredible things. And one of the sad things of this story is Jonah is missing out on the blessings God has for him because he's not obeying God's call. Are you? But there's a huge hope in this story, and it's in chapter 2, and we'll be very brief. Jonah ran away from God to go where God isn't, all the way to hell. And in the place where he thought God would be absent, he meets him. Now, Jonah actually prays two prayers in Jonah chapter 2. You can tell this from the grammar. In Jonah chapter 2, at the beginning, in verse 1, in the past tense, Jonah says, "In my distress, I called to the Lord, and he answered me." When Jonah is thrown into the sea, in distress, he finally calls out to God, "Save me." And he's swallowed by a whale or a big fish. Later in his prayer, it's in the present tense. He's now giving thanks and praise to God from within inside the big fish, from within inside the whale. Now, interestingly, Jonah never really repents. First of all, he says, the cold water, that will wake you up. He says, "God, save me," and he's saved. The fish comes and swallows him. And eventually, in the fish, he says, "God, you're a good God. You are the true God. I will do what you will have me do." There are two different prayers. What does that mean for us? It means, however unworthy you feel right now, however far from God you may be, however deep and low you may have gone, God can save you. It means no matter how terrible the culture is, no matter how much in rebellion it is against God, however far it has gone, there is hope. God can hear. He will hear. Will we pray? Being faithful to God doesn't always mean we will be successful. Isaiah was much more faithful as a prophet than Jonah. Jonah saw huge evangelistic success. Isaiah was cut in half. Which would you rather be? Now that's a hard question. When you pray, do you pray for success or for faithfulness? God asks us to be faithful first. Isaiah is the better prophet. I'm looking at my clock and thinking, what would happen if I preach for another 25 minutes? God can turn around any situation, no matter how hard. I have a friend who mentored me and looked after me for many, many years. He's now also joined our team. If you Google this story, do not believe everything you read about him, my friend Tom. My friend Tom did not assassinate President Kennedy, and he did not assassinate Martin Luther King. Okay, that is not true. It's on the internet, but it's not true. It is true that he ran the most successful terrorist cell in North American history. The CIA tried to kill him. Now, this was very controversial because he was an American living in America. Apparently, the CIA should not kill Americans in America. But there are lots of things the CIA shouldn't do. And I'd just like to say, if you are listening, I love you and respect you. Now, because of his terror, they wanted to kill him. They set up an operation to have him killed, but they captured him by mistake. They put him in prison. He was in maximum security prison for 6 months. He didn't like the accommodation the American government gave him, so he found some friends and he left. When he rejoined his old unit, he didn't know it had been infiltrated by spies. So when he escaped and rejoined this group of terrorists, his location was betrayed. This time, they didn't come with guns. They came with rockets, with grenades, and with tanks. They blew up the buildings on the outside of their camp, killing everyone instantly. And they said, "We have 3 minutes. We're not coming in. If you don't come out, we'll kill you all." So they came out. He was rearrested. He went back to prison. In prison, he's allowed outside once a week for 20 minutes. The rest of the time, he can read. He reads all kind of hate-filled literature. Eventually, he asks if he could read a Bible. He gets as far as reading in the Gospel of Matthew. What does it help someone to gain the world and yet lose their soul? And for the first time, he realized he was a sinner. He was leading a life so in opposition to God, and God met him in a prison cell and changed his life. The transformation in his life was so deep and so obvious, the government in the end decided to release him so that he could speak about how wrong he had been, that the terrible things he was doing needed to be stopped, and urging people to turn to Christ. God can reach you in the deepest of depth. The gospel can change and transform everything. And what we read in the book of Jonah is he will even use non-believers to do it if you won't. The non-believers are saved, and the non-believers give thanks to God. Jonah, when he's still in the whale, is still struggling with God's call on his life, and we'll pick that up tomorrow. Wake up the person next to you. Thank you for listening. May God bless you. Enjoy the rest of the conference.